But life throws little things along the way, and sometimes taking that first step can be difficult, you know, because you just don't want to do it, or the uncertainties of things. So this morning, we're going to continue with our sermon topic, and that is getting your feet wet. And the title this morning is Walking on Water and Getting Wet Feet. We've been talking about this for the last 3 weeks or so. And the first two messages, we looked at what goes on to making a water walker, what you need to do if you want to walk on water. And last week, we examined why we find contentment in the boat. You know, only one disciple slipped over the edge of the boat and walked on water. 11 others stayed in the boat. This week, I want us to look at the principle of faith. And that principle of faith is about getting our feet wet, taking that first step. And so if you will, look at Matthew 14, verses 22 through 33. I want us to reread this passage of Scripture one more time. Probably not the last time, but at least one more time this morning. Immediately after this, after he needed some time away, he sent his disciples across to the other side of the lake. Okay, immediately after this, Jesus insisted that the disciples get back in the boat and cross over to the other side of the lake. Now we'll hear about the storm while he sent the people home. After sending them home, he went up into the hills by himself to pray. Night fell, and there he was alone. Meanwhile, the disciples were in trouble, far away from land, for a strong wind had risen, and they were fighting heavy waves. About 3 o'clock in the morning, Jesus came towards them, walking on the water. When the disciples saw him walking on the water, they were terrified. In their fear, they cried out, "It's a ghost!" But Jesus spoke to them at once. "Don't be afraid," he said. "Take courage. I am here." And Peter called out to him, "Lord, if it's really you, tell me to come to you walking on the water." And Jesus says, "Yes, come." So Peter went over the side of the boat, walked on the water towards Jesus. But when he saw the strong wind and the waves, he was terrified and began to sink. "Save me, Lord," he shouted, and Jesus immediately reached out and grabbed him. "You have so little faith," Jesus said. "Why did you doubt me?" When they climbed back into the boat, the wind stopped. Then the disciples worshiped him. "You really are the Son of God," they exclaimed. There's something exhilarating about stepping out in faith. And I want to say this up front, and that is, it's worth the risk. And so, how many of you have been horseback riding? Okay? How many of you haven't been horseback riding? How many of you aren't really thrilled about horseback riding? Yeah. John Ortberg wrote in his book about a story of his horseback riding experience, but I want to share you my horseback riding experience. Okay? I've got lots of them because I married into a family who did ranching on the side. Her grandfather was an engineer for the railroad, and then when he retired, he actually sold the ranches here in Arizona and moved to northeast New Mexico, north of Klein's Corners. Anyway, with that being said, I was still courting my wife, trying to get her to like me. And it was late in the springtime, and if I'm picturing this right, school must have been out already because she went along. But it was roundup time. We round up the cattle, and then we put them in a corral, and then we brand the new calves and all the stuff that goes along with that. And not only, you know, I had met her grandparents and I had met her uncle before. And my future father-in-law, I think he went along with us on this particular occasion. He had to watch over his daughter and me. And her dad didn't ride horses. He could, but he didn't ride horses. So while we were rounding up the cattle, he fixed up the corral area and got things ready. And so I was placed on a horse by the name of Hezekiah. Hezekiah was not too enthused about going anywhere in a hurry at any time. He was about 10 years old, I'm guessing. He was a very experienced horse, and I was not a very experienced horseman. But I did know this about Hezekiah. Hezekiah, you either had to have some sort of switch to get his attention to move, but I decided I was going to find some spurs to wear. So I bought some spurs. Now, don't get ahead of me on the story. Stay with me. We got up there. I also met Gina's great uncles, all of them who have been on a horse numerous times. And they knew that I wasn't quite as experienced as they were. And so that's why I got Hezekiah. What I didn't know was Hezekiah was a whole lot smarter than I was when it came to rounding up cattle. And so as we went out that morning to bring the herd in, they told me to ride down the fence line. Two reasons for that. Number one, I couldn't get lost. You get to the end of the fence line, you just turn around and you go back. Right? Two, they thought it was safer. I don't think they anticipated what I would find along the way. So I got on Hezekiah, and he quickly realized I didn't have a switch, but I was wearing something different on the heels of my boots. And so he would pick up the pace a little bit more, but he wasn't happy about it. So we're riding along, and my job was, if I saw any cattle, to move them to the fence. And so, and if you've been in the between Thatcher and Duncan, you know there's a lot of rolling hills in that area. And so I'd go up and come down and go up and go down, and I'd find a head, you know, a couple of heads here, three or four here, and they're cast, and push them towards the fence. And I don't know, I might have been out there a couple hours doing this. And then I got to the fence line, to the edge of the corner of the fence line, and there were a bunch of cattle there. So I got them, and I thought, well, I need to push them the other way. And I started pushing them, and lo and behold, when everything, I'm going to give you the end of the story a little bit, when I crest the first hill going back, there must have been a line of cattle from the edge of the fence for about a mile long. I mean, it just stretched one or two, you know, single file or two by two. And, oh, this was cool. No problem. So I'm riding along. Then I got to thinking, in between these hills are like little meadows. Not big, but they're meadows. And you know what grows in there? Fresh grass. And so how am I going to keep these cattle moving forward? So we crest this hill and they start dispersing up this valley. So I kicked Hezekiah in the flanks, and he took off. And from then on, I had no control over that horse. He decided he needed to get back to the corral faster than I needed to get back to the corral. And so he began pushing the cattle where he needs to go. And so we got them bunched up, and we went over the next hill. I'm thinking, oh, here we go again. I didn't have to tell him anything. He took off again and went to where he needed to do, pushed those cattle out of there and kept them moving. Meanwhile, I'm thinking, when is this going to stop? And I see a couple of heads sitting on top of a hill way over there. And then I see another couple of heads of people sitting on horses way over there. And then I see two more guys over here. And they're just sitting there watching me. Why aren't they coming to help me? Come to find out, I had all the cattle stretched out. And then they came to this big area. Just before we had to turn them into the corral, I hadn't a clue what I was going to do. Fortunately, Hezekiah knew. I just held on, kept kicking him, and he kept doing what he does. And pretty soon all these guys came down and they gave me flack about they couldn't find any heads of cattle. Now, I don't know if they pushed them down towards me, but they told me they did not find anything. I had them all. Here's the point. At some point, I was no longer controlling that horse. That horse was controlling me. I was just there for the ride. There's a lot more to that story, but I just want to stop right there. I didn't get thrown. I didn't get bucked off. And we had to go through a culvert underneath the road. But fortunately, we had these other guys doing that. But I was just there for the ride. John Ortberg tells the story of his horseback ride. And like him, my only choice had been to either say, yes, I'm going to ride, or no, I'm not. And I had to decide whether I had enough faith to ride that horse. And when I got on that horse, I didn't have a clue what was going to happen to me. Had I known what was going to happen to me, would I have said yes or no? I don't know. But I know this. If I had said no, I would have missed really an exhilarating ride. A ride of my lifetime. And Ortberg wrote about his experience, once I took a single step, once I got into the saddle, a whole world of experience was set in motion. Everything else was up to the horse. I could not control it, but I could have missed it. You understand what I'm trying to say? I could have missed that experience. Sometimes I wonder if I should have. But the high point of Peter's story is found and contained in a single phrase. Look at our text. In the middle of our text, it said, so Peter walked on water. Peter walked on water. There are many parts to this story. The storm, the fear, the waves, the failure, the critique. And all of these are important parts of the story. And we can learn from them. We should learn from them. But there in the middle is this remarkable occurrence where it says, Peter walked on water. He knew the joy and the freedom of experiencing God's power after taking an enormous risk. And so this morning, here's the question I'm asking you. What are you doing that you could not do apart from the power of God? What are you doing that you could not do apart from the power of God? Because faith is worth the risk. Do you understand what I'm saying? Faith is worth the risk. So, let me talk to you a little bit about the principle of wet feet. If you want to walk on water, you have to be willing to get your feet wet. Seems like a simple principle, doesn't it? If you want to walk on water, you have to risk getting your feet wet. When you do, you'll discover it's worth the risk. When I take the risk of giving generously, I find out that God really can take care of me. When I take the risk of confessing sins, I discover that God will honor truth-telling. When I risk using my spiritual gift, I can know the joy of being used by God. But I have to get my feet wet. The Bible's filled with examples of people who got their feet wet in this principle of wet feet. Moses had to get out and face Pharaoh. This is the guy who ran away and hid for 40 years. But he had to get out of the boat to confront Pharaoh. The Israelites had to get out of the boat and march to the Red Sea before it parted. Then the Israelites had to start across the flooded Jordan River before it parted. Naaman had to wash 7 times in the water before being healed of leprosy. Gideon had to reduce his army from 32,000 men to 300 before being delivered by the Midianites, from the Midianites. Loaves of bread and fish must be relinquished before it can be multiplied. The seed must be buried in the ground and die before it can be raised to greater and more fruitful and have a greater, more fruitful life. You understand where I'm going with this? The wet feet principle begins by my acting in faith, trusting God enough to take a step of obedience. Often the key moments of saying yes to God is not knowing what the implications are going to be. It may be a good thing, I don't know. I may never take that first step if I know. But when I say yes, I set in motion an adventure that will forever change me. Why wouldn't you want to take that step? Why does God want us to get our feet wet? That's probably the question, right? Why does God want us to get our feet wet? Getting out of the boat and getting our feet wet has to do with the nature of faith and how it grows. Follow me. Most people, including myself, often we say we would like to have more faith. I wish I could get more faith. I wish I had more faith. And I was reminded this week as I was preparing this message. We may even beat ourselves up because we don't think we have enough faith. And yet, when Martin Luther, the champion of justification by faith, he knew all about doubts because he wrote this concerning doubts and a lack of faith. It is the devil who puts such ideas in people. Heads and says, you must believe better. You must believe more. Your faith is very strong and it is insufficient. And this way he drives them into deep despair. When you wrestle with doubt, you do sometimes tell yourself that you'll try harder and try to get more faith. But you need to understand, faith is not something you acquire by trying harder. Let me give you an example. If you go to Yellowstone, there's a geyser that goes off about every hour. It goes off about every hour. We know that geyser to be known by the name of Old Faithful. And if I go there and I sit there and watch it shoot off, how do I get more faith that it's going to go off every hour? Do I try harder? Do I just wish upon myself I have faith? You know how I learn? I stand there and I spend time with Old Faithful. And I realize over a period of time that geyser goes off every hour. The more time I spend with Old Faithful, the more faith I have that it's going to go off every hour. Do you follow what I'm trying to say here? You want to have more faith in God, then spend more time with God. You will find Him trustworthy. You'll find Him faithful. And guess what? Your faith becomes stronger. Does that make sense? Or are you just asleep? Never try to have more faith. Just get to know God better. And the next question is, how much faith do I need? You don't need a feeling of certainty. You just need to take that one step. I have a video. Hollywood doesn't always have spiritual meaning, but I can find spiritual meaning in some of the things Hollywood does. Watch this video about a leap of faith. Remember this? Sometimes it just means taking that step. Just means taking that step. I'm sure that Hollywood didn't mean any spiritual ramifications to come from this, but it's a great illustration of what it means to take that step and get your feet wet. How much faith is required? Just enough to take that first step. Imagine what would have happened if Jones or yourself didn't take that first step. So, if you want to walk on water, you have to get your feet wet. And two, you have to expand your spiritual comfort zone. That first step is all about your comfort zone. Most of us have an area that we call our spiritual comfort zone. And that area where we experience our last step of faith is usually our comfort zone area. That one moment that we did take that step of faith, that's our comfort zone. And we relive that comfort zone over and over again. This is the area where we experienced that last step of faith, but we have failed to take another. It's that area where we feel more comfortable trusting God. And when God calls us to go beyond this area, we begin to feel nervous and uncomfortable. For example, we might feel uncomfortable talking about God with church. I'm sorry, we may feel very comfortable talking about God with our church friends, but nervous about explaining our faith to someone who does not believe. We might be comfortable with our current job, but anxious about the possibility that God wants us to do some vocational realignment in our lives. We might discuss the past problems smoothly enough, but the idea of honestly naming current struggles to a trusted friend would send us running. There's only one way to increase your spiritual comfort zone. We need to take another step of faith. We need to get our feet wet again. It's about getting out of the boat a little every day. You begin asking God for wisdom about where you need to get your feet wet that day. Not tomorrow, but that day. Where is God calling you to walk on water right now? Let me give you some indicators that might help you in this area. Four indicators that might help you get your feet wet. And I think these are proven indicators. And these sound negative in nature, but these are I see these as incentives or indicators that God wants us to get our feet wet. And the first one deals with fear. Very often, God will ask you to step out of the boat at the point of our fears. He does so because He wants us to overcome them. He wants us to trust Him. One of the most exciting spiritual adventures in your life is helping find another person find God. What keeps us from getting out of the boat evangelistically? Fear. Fear of what? Fear of what? Experience, ridicule, embarrassment, rejection. Or we might actually be a part of God's redemptive purpose on earth if we would just slip out and get our feet wet. God called me to youth ministry many years ago, 1984. Our son was born in 84, so that would be almost 40 years ago. My first ministry experience wasn't all that great, but we went to another church and on the west side of town, and we spent about 4 years there at that church. And I remember the first year there, we had a student that showed up, and I didn't know any better. You know, he showed up, so I thought I needed to show up at his house. I didn't know any better. And so I made a visit. And I don't have that Bible with me right now, but it was a big black Thompson chain howitzer. You know what I'm talking about, right? It was about yay thick. And I brought that, and I thought it was more for my comfort than anything. You know, you remember Crocodile Dundee when somebody pulled out a little knife and they said, yeah, give me your, he's got a knife, you got to do something. Oh, I ain't knife. He pulls out that big knife. That's how I felt with this big Bible. And that boy's dad happened to be home, and I was invited in. They asked, you want a beer? No, I probably don't need a beer. I just wanted to talk to you and talk to him. He said, about what? Well, about our church. And, well, tell me about your church. Tell me about God. Okay. So I took my Bible and I turned to Romans. Got to Romans and got to the first verses. No. Put that down. I want you to tell me. Now, do what? Put it down. So I put it down on the coffee table. And I had to take him through the Roman road without opening my Bible. I don't know how many verses I might have missed up along the way. But I kept saying, God tells me, we all sin and fall short of His glory. We are all sinners. God tells me that if we confess with our mouth and believe in our heart that Jesus was raised from the dead, we could have eternal life. I kept going back to the Bible, but I never once had to open the Bible. I was there about 20 minutes, shared with the faith. He was quite impressed, but I said, so what do you decide? What are you going to decide today? What are you going to do about God today in your life? Well, I'm going to contemplate on it just a little bit longer. That's all. What would you do if you had to share Jesus with somebody? You had your Bible with you, but you couldn't use it. Could you tell your story? Would you be willing to slip over the side of the boat and get your feet wet? Tell you, it's an act of faith. Imagine having God use you to speak to another person about His redemptive purpose. Instead of letting your fear put you in avoidance mode, it may be an indicator telling you that God wants to use you. But you have to get your feet wet to find out. The second indicator is frustration. People sometimes get motivated to trust God in remarkable ways when they grow frustrated with the brokenness of the fallen world. For example, Nehemiah, David, Elijah. None of those guys could tolerate the fallenness of their times. People today are often moved to actions when frustrated by the gap between reality and God's desires. Henrietta Mears is one of those people who is motivated by her frustration. You may not know who she is. Henrietta Mears taught college students for decades at First Presbyterian Church in Hollywood, California. She was a formative influence on the life of a whole generation of Christian leaders, including Billy Graham, Billy Bright, former Senate Chaplain Richard Havertson, and hundreds of others. She became frustrated at not being able to have her students first-rate materials to educate them. So she began a little publishing company or publishing enterprise out of her garage. And it grew significantly to an enterprise that we know of, although it they have sold out and stopped publishing, a little company called Gospel Light Publishing. Well, she was also frustrated that there was no place for Christians in the LA area where they could go and withdraw and be with God for a period of time. So she founded a Forest Home Christians Conference Center in the San Bernardino Mountains. Her book, What the Bible is All About, has sold over 3 million, maybe more. And it came about because of her frustration of having no introductory book about the Bible. She was frustrated, so she was motivated to do something about it. Maybe God is calling you to do something because of your frustration, and now it's time for you to get your feet wet. Listen, no one ever regretted trusting Christ more. There's a third indicator, and that's compassion. Compassion. There's a story about a guy by the name of Toby. Toby was able to take a 2.5-week trip, study tour of Africa through World Vision. He was not only struck by the beauty of Ethiopia, but also by the rampant poverty of Ethiopia. After handing out food and supplies at a distribution camp, the group was getting ready to leave when Toby was approached by an 11-year-old boy whose t-shirt was dirty, thin, and filled with holes. The young boy tasked Toby if he could have his t-shirt, Toby's t-shirt. The day had just begun and Toby didn't have another shirt to put on, and not having another shirt under the hot African sun wasn't an option for him. As they drove away, the weight of that request gripped Toby and would not let him go. He continued to think about that boy for the rest of the trip and beyond his return to Michigan. Toby was resolved, because of his compassion, to do something about it. So he prayed to God and asked what could be done. So he began to organize a t-shirt drive called Give the Shirt Off Your Back. He started collecting t-shirts door to door. He persuaded some convenience stores in the area to set out bins collecting t-shirts. The local media got news of the story and gave it some airtime. The next thing Toby knew, he had collected over 10,000 t-shirts. Toby faced another problem, getting t-shirts from Michigan to Ethiopia. The cost of shipping 2 tons of t-shirts at that time was over $65,000. So Toby prayed again. And finally, he got in touch with an organization called Supporters of Sub-Saharan Africa. They were willing to ship supplies to Africa for him. But they told Toby they can only take him to one country. And they wanted to know if it would be all right if they could take those shirts to Ethiopia. Maybe a strong surge of compassion is how God will indicate to you that it's time for you to get your feet wet. And when we risk the last time you took a serious, maybe perhaps when you got your feet wet the last time was when you had a serious compassion about something. The fourth indicator is the indicator of prayer. Both in Scripture and in present day, stories of water walking are always stories about prayer. There's something about getting out of the boat that turns people into prayers. Not prayer, prayers. When you're getting out of the boat, you're praying that you don't sink. That's because we're fully aware that we can't accomplish things without God's help. Let me tell you about Bob. Bob. An insurance agent who lived in Washington, D.C., and he was a new Christian. He was all excited about a statement in the Bible. The statement was this. It's where Jesus says, "Ask whatever you will in my name, and you shall receive it." You shall receive it. So he asked his friend if this was really a true verse. And his friend explained that while the statement is not a blank check, and one needs to take it in context of teaching of the whole scripture on prayer, yes, it is correct. It is true. Bob thought that was great and told his friend that he was going to start praying for something. He was going to start praying for Africa. His friend helped him understand that Africa was a pretty large continent and that perhaps Bob needed to narrow that country down within that continent. So Bob, who had no government connection whatsoever, he was an insurance agent. He was not in politics. He had no government agency connections at all, began to pray for a little country called Kenya. His friends also challenged him to pray every day for Kenya for at least 6 months. And Bob began to pray for Kenya. And for a long time, nothing appeared to be happening. Then one night, you know where we're going, because there's always then, right? Then one night at a dinner party, the people around the table shared what they did for a living. One woman said she helped run an orphanage in Kenya, the largest of its kind. So when she spoke the name Kenya, Bob, up to this point, hadn't said a whole lot at all, began to ask her relentlessly, question after question. Overwhelmed by the question, the woman asked, "Have you ever been to Kenya?" "No." "Do you know somebody in Kenya?" "No." "Then how do you happen to be so curious?" And Bob explained to the woman that he had been praying for Kenya for some time now. But the woman interrupted Bob's explanation and asked, "Would you like to come to Kenya and tour the orphanage?" Bob was so eager to go, he would have left that very night if he could. And upon arriving in Kenya, he was appalled by the poverty and lack of basic health care. When he returned back to Washington, he began to write to large pharmaceutical companies, describing to them the vast need he had seen. He reminded them that every year they would throw away large amounts of medical supply that went unsold. So why not send them to this place in Kenya? And some of them began to do so. And this orphanage received over $1 million worth of medical supplies. The woman called Bob again. "Bob, this is amazing. We've had the most phenomenal gifts because of the letters you wrote. Would you like to fly back to Kenya? Will you come?" So Bob again flew back to Kenya. And while he was there, the president of Kenya came to the celebration because, of course, this was the largest orphanage in the country, and offered to take Bob on a tour to Nairobi. In the course of the tour, I know this is a long story, stay with me. In the course of the tour, he saw a prison, and Bob asked about the group of prisoners that were in this prison. They're political prisoners, the president told Bob. Well, that's a bad idea, Bob said brightly. You should let them out. Bob finished the tour and flew back home. Sometime later, Bob received a phone call from the State Department of the United States government. Is this Bob? Yes. Were you recently in Kenya? Yes. Did you make any statements to the president about political prisoners? Yes. What did you say to him? I told him he should let them out. The State Department officials explained that they had been working for years to get the release of these prisoners to no avail. Normal diplomatic channels and political maneuvering had led to a dead end. But now the prisoners had been released, and the State Department was told it was largely because of what Bob said to the president of the country. Several months later, the president of Kenya made a phone call to Bob. He was going to rearrange his government and select a new cabinet. Would Bob be willing to fly over and pray for him for 3 days while he worked on this very important task? So Bob, who was not politically connected at all, boarded an airplane once more, flew back to Kenya, where he prayed and asked God to give wisdom to the leader of the nation as he selected his government. All of this happened because one man chose to get out of the boat and get his feet wet. And the question now is, what about you? What are you praying for? Walking on water is not about some great thing you will do. In fact, by yourself, you could do nothing of lasting value. It's about what God longs for you to do by His power and grace. But first, folks, we've got to get our feet wet. Would you pray with me? Father, we are grateful this morning for these stories about faith. Ordinary people doing extraordinary things because they depended and trusted in you. They took that step of faith, slipped over the side of the boat, and got their feet wet. Help us to do the same. Get us out of our comfort zone. Use us in ways that we could never do ourselves because we're trusting in you and we're trusting in your power. Let us not be satisfied with the steps we had previously taken, these previous steps of faith. Let us step out fresh. Let us take that step of faith again. Let us get our feet wet again. Father, there may be somebody here this morning that is struggling with the decision about whether to let you in their life or not. Let them take that step of faith to get their feet wet. They won't be disappointed. We know that. Let them know. Let them know that they won't be disappointed. Father, keep banging on the doors of their hearts. Let them come. This morning, have your way with us. Direct us. Use us. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask you to stand. We're going to have a hymn of decision, a hymn of commitment, a hymn of invitation, inviting you to get your feet wet this morning. I'm going to ask Carl to come up front. If Carl's overwhelmed, we've got another deacon over here. We've got a deacon emeritus who will struggle to stand on his feet to get to the front, but I know he will. If you need to get your feet wet, maybe you just need to come to the altar. Or maybe you can just make an altar right where you're at. Allow God to have His way in your life this morning as we sing. You come.